morning, everyone. Thank you for being here today. And of course, we all gather here in the name of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And so may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. For our gathering hymn, our opening hymn, please take the insert that you found in your bulletin. This is an old hymn. In fact, all of our hymns today are old. And we want you to belt them out because they should be familiar to you, to most of you anyway. But they're always fun to sing. And please take note of the words. There's wonderful poetry in hymns. This hymn, called Hiding in Thee, is an old gospel song. And it comes from, it's inspired, I think, from a passage in the book of Exodus in the Old Testament where it's described that Moses is coming to God and is talking to God as the only one who has this privilege, talking to God as a friend. But Moses wanted more. He wanted more evidence of God. And so he said to God, he couldn't see God, of course. God is invisible. So he asked God pretty emphatically to let him see him. Let me see your face. And God said, well, I will pass by you in all my glory, but you cannot see my face. So here where I am, there's a cleft in the rock, and I will pass by you, and you will know that I am with you, but you cannot see my face, because, of course, the Hebrews believed that to see God would mean to die. You could not stand it to be in God's visible presence. And so the story goes that he passed by Moses, but he held his hand against Moses' back and passed by so that Moses could only see him going away. Not see him face to face. And so here's the hymn of devotion, oh, safe to the rock that is higher than I. My soul in its conflicts and sorrows would fly. So is that a sickness?
Thank you. wish you a warm welcome. And as far as the announcements go, I only have one to say, that there will be a church service next Sunday. There will be communion, and Kent will be back. And there will be no coffee this morning. If you'll join me in the call to worship, in the response. We welcome this day carrying joys and sorrows. Open our hearts to share our journeys. We come this day from a world that can be judgmental and harsh. Open our hearts to welcome our neighbor. We come this day seeking guidance and strength. Open our hearts to receive your word. We have come this day to worship. Open our hearts to the presence of God. And now the prayer of approach. Loving God, you live in us through the Spirit. We feel your holy breeze upon our hearts, as surely as the trees feel the gentle wind on their leaves. Give us the courage and the strength today to follow Christ, to let the Spirit guide our lives, to let it fill our sails and carry us forward, so that we may be the winds of change in a complacent world. Through your love, O God, all is possible.
I don't think I should get it.
The scripture readings this morning are from 2 Samuel chapter 6, verses 1 to 5 and 12 to 15. There are many places in this scripture. I hope you can say it better than I. David again gathered all the chosen men of Israel, 30,000. David and all the people with him set out and went from Valley of Judah to bring out from there the Ark of God, which is called by the name of the Lord of Hosts, who is enthroned on a cherubim. They carried the Ark of God on a new cart and brought it out of the house of Abinadab, which was on the hill. Uzzah and Ahio, the sons of Abinadab, were driving the new cart with the Ark of God, and Ahio went in front of the ark. David and all of the house of Israel were dancing before the Lord with all their might, with the songs and lyres and harps and tambourines and castanets and cymbals. So David went and brought up the Ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom to the city of David with rejoicing. David danced before the Lord with all his might. David was girded with a linen ephod. So David and all the house of Israel brought up the Ark of the Lord with shouting and the sound of the trumpet. And the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 14, verses 13 to 19. When Jesus heard of it, he departed thence by ship into a desert place apart. And when the people had heard thereof, they followed him on the foot of the cities. And Jesus went forth and saw a great multitude, and was moved with compassion toward them, and he healed their sick. And when it was evening, his disciples came to him, saying, "This is a desert place, and the time is now past. Send the multitude away, that they may go into the villages and buy themselves food to eat." But Jesus said unto them, "They need not depart. Give ye them to eat." And they say unto him, "We have here but 5 loaves and 2 fishes." He said, "Bring them here to me." And he commanded the multitude to sit down on the grass, and took the 5 loaves and the 2 fishes, and looking up to heaven, he blessed and brake, and gave the loaves to his disciples, and the disciples to the multitude. May the Holy Spirit bless these readings to our understanding. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
I had a thought when Audrey, our lady leader, mentioned that she hoped that she could get all the names right. I had a thought that if Audrey had problems, Nancy Scott would be glad to in the way that the lessons are rotate. When Nancy is the lay leader, sure thing as we're standing here, there'll be some fancy names that she has to get her tongue around. She does a very good job too.
Thank you.
Well, I am going to turn my machine off here. I'm going to preach from the story of David in 2 Samuel, where David was as the general of the Israelite army, made up of people from all Israel, was able to recapture the Ark of the Covenant again, that sacred box that carried the two tablets of stone, and he was on his way to present it in Jerusalem. That this was before the time of the temple, and it was a pretty primitive time yet, but it shows the heroism that the people regarded, in which the people regarded David as their king. And what I want to focus on is David's reaction on the way as the Ark of the Covenant processed back to Jerusalem in victory. David was so exuberant and joyful that he danced before the ark with all his might. And that's what makes the story significant and important, was the fact that was his reaction to it. But I'm also going to invite you to this morning to engage with me in a little memory exercise that I'm sure that most of you will be able to do. We'll call it Remember When. And the title of the sermon is Dancing into the Fullness of Life. But remember one of those summer activities of years ago, almost an institution in many towns you and I came from. Now long gone, because there are not enough people in those places to support it, or because people have the money now to go away frequently. I'm referring to the Saturday night dance, would you believe? It was one of those institutions of the small town experience that shaped us as social beings, perhaps more than we realize. Remember it? Or a variation of it in your young life? I certainly do. It was like a centerpiece of community life in summer. Something most everyone looked to, forward to. A social ritual in which many of us as teenagers began to learn our identity, discover our talents, and gain some self-confidence for getting started in life. Now, at the risk of sounding something like Tales of Woebegone, of Lake Woebegone by humorous Garrison Keillor, I grew up in a small community where the Saturday night dance in summer was the focus, even the objective for daily life throughout the week. My father had played the E-flat Elvis saxophone and clarinet for years. I remember he could do those high jazzy notes like Fred Miller or Benny Goodman. And he was very good at it. And then he started out in the 1930s for the awesome sum of $5 a night. And was probably felt that he was well paid then. The big band sounds of Glenn Miller and Benny Goodman and Guy Lombardo resonated in our home and vibrated in my bones because my dad celebrated them so much. And you talk to Gary Gillickson there, he tells about playing in a dance band when he was young too and had a lot of fun doing it. Besides that, my parents taught us kids to dance, and to dance well, meaning an accurate and well-defined sense of rhythm and creative looseness of the body that allowed us to feel the music and move with it to express some joy and spontaneity through it. So on Saturday nights in summer, the town would be transformed, swelled much beyond its resident population. Main Street and the side streets lined with vehicles from the country. Stores crowded until 9 o'clock at night for people to do their shopping and visiting. And then it seemed like nearly everyone went to the hall where the band was tuning up. In my days, it was George on the E-flat alto sax, another George on the tenor sax. Sometimes Floyd came down from Regina with his slide trombone and joined them. Norman on the drums and Eleanor on the piano. And believe me, Eleanor could play almost anything, just off the cuff. So by 10 o'clock, you couldn't move. You could hardly move. Then at midnight, when the last waltz, many would linger at the adjacent cafe and ice cream parlor for a last treat, really wanting to extend the beauty and creative ambience of the evening, young people with their dates sharing an ice cream soda. Now it occurs to me that in the art or the sport, if you like, of dancing, as with other performing talents or social rituals we do, we are making a statement about life, about our attitude toward life, about our belief in confidence for the future. Besides that, to go to a dance is like stepping out of time to celebrate life in all its goodness, to affirm the value of other persons, and to experience something of our common origins and equal status as human beings. The weekly Jewish observance of the Sabbath is intended to do this social transformation as well, to an even more marked degree, as an occasion simply to enjoy the company of other persons, with music now proven to be one of the best forms of therapy for pain and healing. It's noteworthy too that many of the homes and senior high rises, seniors' homes and senior high rises that we visit, have regularly skipped
tap their feet and keep time and sing the old songs. Well, other art forms may accomplish the same thing. For me, choral music does it, both listening to it and especially performing it in the middle of an ensemble. To completely be lost and totally absorbed by the collective sound of many singers working together to follow the conductor up front. Quite simply, I have to sing. To draw apart from the helter-skelter or burden of life, so that the beautiful music a choral ensemble makes will lift me in spirit and send me home energized for the new challenges ahead. The friendships also that develop, being a significant and lasting bonus to the experience. And of course, we all know that the dance also helps to celebrate significant transition points in life, like marriages or anniversaries or bar mitzvahs. You have never witnessed the joy and exuberance of life until you watch a bar mitzvah taking place, as we did at the hotel where we stayed in Jerusalem. And then, finally, the dance is a significant defining, as a significant defining event is also a way to understand this, the biblical story that we focus on today. David dancing before the ark is not simply an isolated exhibitionist moment that David wanted to do, after which he would get over it and return to the serious business of becoming king. Well, that was how Michal, the daughter of the deposed and now dead King Saul, thought of it. With some enmity, she said to David, in effect, "At your age, behave as a king. Instead of lowering yourself to the level of an uninhibited animal." She couldn't get it. She couldn't understand it. What was happening? And she resented David anyway. So she's an important part of the story. Well, do you and I realize that without this crucial event recorded in Samuel chapter 6, there may have never been a Jerusalem, never been a temple, never have been a school of learned priests and scholars, never have been the collection of sacred writings and records and worship songs that galvanized these people into a formidable nation on the international scene for a time, from whom evolved a religious story and tradition and experience that sustained them during terrible times of national collapse and war and exile and Holocaust, that raised them up to recover and to take up the dance again of life. It is an historic narrative, a long tradition that finally shaped a young Nazarene with the name of Jesus to lead the way in teaching God's words and way, and which we have inherited after 3,000 years since it began. This should give us some idea, some strong suggestions as to what our program, both in life and in the church. Most importantly, in a world of human violence and destruction because of unbridled evil, because of a vast sense of the loss of God and the meaning of love. Because of personal tragedies that strike us, for which we're not prepared, we need to make room for the deaths and be joyful and enjoy other people who are fellow travelers with us, fellow dancers, so that we believe that life, what we are saying with the dance is that life will prevail and survive because of a God who creates and sustains life even beyond death. As our creed says, we are not alone, we live in God's world, in life, in death, in life beyond death, God is with us. Thanks be to God. And just as God's people of old experienced, so with the abiding presence of God in grace, in our lives of service, we will have the strength to persist and renew our commitment to the causes of righteousness and justice in which God leads us. For the eternal truth should be crystal clear to us. The dance takes us right into the world where life and death struggle. With a message of life, of eternal life in God. The message here is that we can still do our dance in our life and work. Perhaps smaller numbers being an advantage for focus and clarity and intentionality, thus making yet a significant impact on society. I'm talking about the church and its mission. To put it more strongly, we must do our dance of life as joyously as we can, to continue to say that there are realities of the Spirit that give life and restore life and present the hope of a saving God, known especially in Jesus Christ. To proclaim that what we do as a church of worship and in mission is that we are dancing into the fullness of life. Not alone, but with others. Keeping the rhythm going. Teaching a new generation to do the dance. Helping those who have never heard of God's dance to learn it and get in step. So I say to you, from all this, and I say it with great joy, make sure you go to the dance. Be challenged to participate and share with others. Get out there on the floor with others. Tap your feet and clap your hands as you enjoy the music of creation. And thereby say loudly and clearly that life is good. That love exists and joins us one to another. And that all good things that go with the dance are gifts of the eternal God. Thanks be to God. To God alone be all the glory. Amen. And we're going to sing a hymn. Come. From the Voices United hymn book. Come celebrate. Come let us sing of the wonderful love found in 574 in Voices United. We'll sing.
first two verses, and I ask you to just remain seated as we enjoy this hymn and its message.
Thank you.
as we lead into the prayers this morning, concluding prayers, I ask that we sing a couple of verses of another favorite hymn, found in Voices United at 559. We'll sing the first two verses as we remain seated again. Come, O Father, every blessing.
Church to keep alive the need for justice in providing
sharing of resources, that peace may truly come. Bless our ministry and our congregation as we think about the sick and the poor and the sorrowful, that we might provide the assurance of your presence and the hope of salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord. We bring these and other prayers to you, offer them to you humbly and out of a sense of the need of our needs in our world. We pray through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught his disciples when they prayed to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever. Well, let's conclude our service with another old favorite, found in Voices United at 675, When Your Anchor Hold in Storms of Life. Let us stand and sing. Thank you.
In the name of the Father, we pray. Amen. And now for our concluding rousing benediction. The words present right from the book.
Go now in peace. Amen.